Why did the Shaykh rahimahullah mention and say that his book, it consists of, first of all, it's waraqat. It's only pages that consist in it fusul. Meaning you're going to learn masail, 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 masail. Those masail are coming together, makes a what? A fasal. Why would he say that? Because he wants to do litanshit nafs, to give you the enthusiasm that you need as a student of knowledge. In order to be consistent in carry on and studying. Why? Because look, when a book is chaptered kitab, and then it's chaptered bab, so it's a kitab. If the whole kitab was open, no babs, just beginning and end, will you have any enthusiasm? But remember, when you say kitab, hayya, and then what happens is bab, and then you go, and what's it called, fusul, and then masail. When you finish one mas'ala, you go to the next mas'ala, your heart finds tranquility. Alhamdulillah, I've done, I achieved something. And then another one, alhamdulillah. The more it's broken down, the more a person can carry on. So when a person does mas'ala, he finishes masail, what does he go to? Faslun. And then when he does fasal, what does he come to? Babun. He's like, I'm moving, mashallah. And then when he finishes many babs, he says, I finished the kitab, here it is. So it is what? لتنشيط النفس, to give the person the ability and the enthusiasm wanting to carry on in order to seek and consistently carry on and have happiness by starting and finishing it off. The same way كالمسافر إذا قطع مرحلة, just like the traveler, if he cuts a distance from his journey, if he is told you are now this much distance is remaining, he finds happiness. And this is how much you cut. Alhamdulillah. But if what about if he's told, come, keep it moving. And he's like, how many distance have I cut? He's like, we say to him, we don't know. Just be quiet, shh, keep it moving. And there was no services, and there was no stopping, and there's no places where you can stop before you reach your... People would just say, you know, I'm going home. I don't know what's happening. Am I halfway? Have I one third? How far am I? We give up. So the Shaykh rahimahullah, this is why he mentions that the kitab is fusul. Now, then he says, min usul al-fiqh. Min usul al-fiqh. Usul al-fiqh, as we said, is the field that we're studying. And it's the name of this fan, this field in which we're studying. So now what we're going to do is we're going to define it, bi-i'tibari mufradayhi. Looking at usul by itself, and then looking at itself. We're going to be taking it singularly, each one by itself. تعريف أصول الفقه باعتبار مفرديه. Now we're going to define أصول الفقه from the angle of what? باعتبار مفرديه, by looking at it singularly. فالأصل, أصل is what? ما يبنى عليه غيره. أصل linguistically means لغة. Write it down. أصل فالأصل. Then what we learn is what? أصول is جمع. جمع التكسير. Good. And أصل is the singular. Usul is plural. And what does it mean linguistically? It means ما يبنى عليه غيره. It is what mad things are built on. It is what things is built on. So the ground here is the what? It's the asal. What is it? The foundation. It is the asal. It is the, like what? كأصل الجدار. Like the asal of the jidar, which is the walls. This wall, the asal of it, right at the bottom. What is it? The? It is the asal. Jidar means wall. Where is? Na'am. وهو أساسه, and it's the foundation in which he comes out. المستتر في الأرض المبني عليه الجدار. which where it's on the ground, it's rooted on the ground, it comes out. The same is aslu shajara, like the foundation of the tree. As Allah said in the Qur'an, مَا قَطَعْتُم مِّن لِينَةٍ أَوْ تَرَكْتُمُوهَا قَائِمَةً عَلَىٰ أُصُولِهَا فَالْأَصْلُ الشَّجَرَةِ The foundation, the bottom, the root, where it stems from, that is called asl, foundation. And the branches and the leaves that come out is called what? It is called the fara. And it's the branches and the stem. All of, the branches and the leaves, are they built on top of the asal? Yes. So the tree stands, the leaves and the branches, they stand on what? The asal, which is the root, the bottom. Good. وَهُوَ مَا يُبْنَى عَلِهِ غَيْرُهُ And as Allah said in Surah Ibrahim, Ayah 24, أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا كَلِمَةً طَيِّبَةً كشجرة طيبة أصلها ثابت وفرعها في السماء كلمة التوحيد أصلها ثابت foundation وفرعها and some branches that is what it means linguistically. Did we define what it means لغة? Yes, linguistically it means that which things are built on. That's the أصل. What does it technically mean? Technically it means معاني, many meanings it can. According to the Usuliyin, so when we're defining the word asal, according to the Usuliyin, the word asal has many meanings, not one meaning. According to who? According to this field, the people who are the scholars of this field, they define the word asal istilahan, according to them, as one. First one is ad-dalil, evidence. They refer to evidence as asal. So they sometimes say, الأصل وجوب الصوم أصل وجوب الصوم They mean دليل وجوب الصوم The evidence that fasting is obligatory Instead of saying evidence they probably sometimes use أصل وجوب الصوم And they read the ayah يا أيها الذين آمنوا كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون إذن They will say, instead of evidence, asal. So asal and dalil, according to Usulian, is the same. Two. So what do we say? We say, ad-dalilu, the dalil is what? So asal. So as I said, aslu wujubu sawm. أصل وجوب الصوم أصل وجوب الصوم The evidence of the obligation and that it's mandatory fasting is the speech of Allah يا أيها الذين آمنوا كتب عليكم الصيام Oh those of you who believe fasting has been made obligatory on you أي دليله أي meaning دليله So what do we say أي دليله أي أصله The evidence is for it نعم And remember as a side benefit And the word A, for example, now what I just said was, the sharih Abdullah ibn Fawzan in the sharah, look what he said. He said, الدليل كقولنا أصل وجوب الصوم. قوله تعالى يا أيها الذين آمنوا كتب عليكم الصيام. أي دليله. We will say دليله بضم اللام. We put ضم on top of the lam. Why would we say دليله? Why after A? Why after A does it take luhu? Because the dalil here is taking the place of what? Asl. The word asl that was just passed previously, which is aslu. And according to the grammarians, is A is either a atfu bayan or a badal. Qa'idatun tashfil alila. They say a qa'ida that cures a person min al-ilali. From any form of deficiency and illness. It's a line of poetry. قاعدة تشفي العليلة من العلل ما بعد أي عطف بيان أو بدل. Anything that falls after the word أي in the Arabic language is عطف بيان أو بدل. So what you say is أصدليله. It's important. The second one is قاعدة القاعدة المستمرة. قاعدة المستمرة is the second one. أصل also means قاعدة المستمرة. What does قاعدة المستمرة mean? It means the ongoing principle. So sometimes they refer to أصل as what? Ongoing principle. What do they mean by that? It means eating, are you all with me? Eating a dead. For it to be permitted for you. Is that going against original consistent principle, which is that dead is what? It's haram for you. So they would say, إِبَاحَةُ الْمَيْتَةِ, to permit for you the dead. لِلْمُطَّرِّ, for the one who is in a state of necessity. عَلَى خِلَافِ الْأَصْلِ, it is opposite to the asal. What's the asal is the opposite to? A قاعدة المستمرة. The ongoing, the consistent evidence, principle, which was that the dead animal cannot be eaten. Now, you eating it, you're going against the qaida. But you're allowed to because there's a reason for you to go against it. Which is what? Iddirar, necessity. The third one is, al-maqisu alayhi. Al-maqisu alayhi is also referred to according to the usuliyin, they refer to it as what? Asal. Al-maqisu alayhi means what? Al-maqisu alayhi, it is what you would do the analogy from, the thing that you do the analogy from, is what you do the analogy from. Pay attention. If I want to say, this thing is haram because it intoxicates your mind, which one am I taking the analogy, which one am, this thing has never been seen at the time of the Prophet. It came out recently. Drugs, مثلا. Are you with me? Somebody says to me, what is the ruling on drugs? I say it's haram. He says to you, at the time of the messenger, alayhi salatu wassalam, what they used to drink is liquid. This one is something you put into your skin. Huh? You take a syringe and you inject it into yourself. He says to you, how is it haram? You will say to him, what was the thing that the Prophet prohibited? Which one are you taking the analogy from? The khamar. The khamar is al-maqisu alayhi. The thing which you're taking the qiyas from, the analogy, that is called asal. That's the asal. And what you're going to take the qiyas for is called fara. It's a sub-branch, which is the drugs. That usuliyin call it asal. Also, what are you going to do? You're going to look for a illah, a reasoning that they both share. Illah in which they share, which is what? Intoxication. And then you give them the same ruling, which is hurma, tahrim. You say it's both of them are haram. Those are the four pillars of qiyas. Al-asl wal-far' wal-hukm wal-illah. So the asl is called al-maqisu alayhi, in the thing which you take the qiyas from. Pay attention. It's important. Good. Then the author said after that, rahimahullah, wal-fiqhu, wal-far'u ma yubna alayhi ghayruh. And the far' which is the opposite to asl is what? Huwa ma yubna alayhi ghayruh. It is what? It's the thing that's been built upon the asal. The fara' means what? Sub-branches. It is what stems from. It is what comes from the foundation. It's what's built upon the foundation. That's called fara'. Anything that's built upon the foundation, built on top of it, it's called sub-branch. It's called fara'. It's called what? It's called fara'. It's called fara'. Some of the ulama that the sharah of the kitab, like al-anjum al-zahira, ala halli al-fadil waraqat, al-imam al-mardini, who was a Shafi'i scholar, he done the sharah of waraqat. When he came to the fara' that Abu Mu'alim al-Juwayni rahimahullah mentions in his waraqat, he said that Abu Mu'alim al-Juwayni fell into what? He said he fell into istidrad, meaning he went off topic. But that's not the case. That is not the case. Rather, he has explained for you the opposite. أَضِدُّ بِالضِّدْ يُعْرَفْ وَبِهِ تَتَمَيَّزُ الْأَشْيَاء. An opposite, you can know, it's, if you want to know something, it's easy to remember it with its opposite. And things become clear for you, when you're told, and the opposite. So, defining fara is not istidrad. I mean, it's not him going off topic. And istidrad, and ikhwani, it means dhikru shay, it is to mention something في غير محله, in not, is to mention something in not in a place which isn't its place. But you're mentioning it لمناسبة, there is a relation between it. Here, he's not going off topic. It's not istidrad, rather it is something one needs to know. So we defined asal linguistically and we defined it technically. We are now swiftly moving on to the definition of the word al-fiqh, which is the second part. Juz'u thani, the second part, al-fiqh. Fiqh, lughatan, brothers, linguistically, it means al-fahm, understanding. It means comprehension, understanding. That's what it means. You would say, for instance, فَهْمُ غَرَضِ الْمُتَكَلِّمِ مِنْ كَلَامِهِ. It is to understand, it is to comprehend, it is to learn and have understanding of somebody's speech. As Allah said in the Qur'an, فَمَا لِهَؤُلَاءِ الْقَوْمِ لَا يَكَادُونَ يَفْقَهُونَ حَدِيثًا أَيْ يَفْهَمُونَ حَدِيثًا. Nabiullah Musa, what did he say? He said, اللهم اجعل لي وزيرا من أهلي هارون أخي أشتد به أزري وأشركه في أمري كي نصبحك كثيرا ونذكرك كثيرا إنك كنت بنا بصيرا. That he said before that. Before that, what's the beginning of the ayah? قال ربي جرع قال ربي اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري وأحلل عقدة من لساني. Take from my mouth عقد. عقد means a knot. Take the knot. Then give me eloquency. وأحلل عقدة من لساني. Why? يفقهوا قولي. أي يفهموا قولي. So they can understand my speech. My speech. So the word al-fiqh, lughatan, it means al-fahm. It means fahm. Al-Jawhari rahimahullah, he was one of the great the ulama of the language. He has a book called As-Sihah. He says, قال الجوهري. Jawhari said, al-fiqh, fiqh means al-fahm, understanding. تقول, you will say, فقه الرجل, the man has understood. بالكسري, you say, فقه, فقه, with a kasra. وفلان لا يفقه. And Fulan does not understand. وَلَا يَنْفَقُهُ. نعم. وَلَا يَنْقَهُ. نعم. وَلَا يَنْقَهُ. And he doesn't come to understand. Fulan لا يَفْقَهُ وَلَا يَنْقَهُ. Fulan has not any ability to comprehend and understand. نعم. ثم after that, خُسَّ بِهِ عِلْمُ الشَّرِيعَةِ. The word fiqh, even that it means understanding, it then got specified for the sharia, specifically to the sharia. وَالْعَالِمُ بِهِ فَقِيه. The alim is faqih. So you say فَقُهَ بِالضَّمِّ فَقَاهَةً وَفَقَهَ وَتَفَقَّهَ. إِذَا تَعَاطَى ذَلِكَ. If he takes that thing. تَعَاطَى بِمَعْنَى أَخَذَ ذَلِكَ. If he takes it. So fiqh lughatan, it means al-fahm, comprehension, understanding. What does it mean technically? What does it mean istilahan, technically according to the ulama? It means ma'rifatul ahkam al-shar'iyya. It means understanding. Before I move on to that, it's important that I mention a matter, which is what? The word al-fiqh. Now I'll mention it when I speak about it technically. It's ma'rifa. What does ma'rifa mean, brothers? Ma'rifa means two things. Al-ilmu is having knowledge of sorry. Al-ma'rifa means what? Al-yaqeen wa-dhan. It is to have knowledge of something, either by way of certainty or by way of assumption. High assumption. Are you with me? So yaqeen, based on what? It is based upon yaqeen. Ma'rifa encompasses yaqeen and it also encompasses dhan. Pay attention. Yaqeen means what? Huwa ma udrika idrakan jaziman. Yaqeen means what? Something which a person perceives with full conviction. That's what yaqeen means. Whereas dhan means ma udrika, it is something a person perceives ala wajhi rajih. It's 90% in your mind, or 80%. 80% you believe this is how it is. But there is that doubt which is present in you. There's that doubt which is present in you. And why do we say that fiqh, the definition is ma'rifah? The first one is ma'rifah. Why? Because fiqh is based upon yaqeen, certainty, and it's also the majority of it is based on what? the majority of it is based upon dhan. Why is it based upon dhan? Because it's going to come to us. It's based upon dhan. Why is it based upon dhan? Because the next part is going to mention it. He says what? Allati. What's the reason? Allati tariquha. It means is what? Ma'rifatu al-ahkam al-shar'iyya. It is to learn the ahkam of the sharia. You see? Allati tariquha. Its path is based upon what? Al-ijtihad. Basing the understanding and the comprehension, the ma'rifa is based upon what? It is based upon ijtihad, striving, putting effort in. And putting effort in something, what does it enter? It involves dhan, doubts and assumption coming from it. Your striving may be right, may not be right. So it is basing your striving, your understanding of something is based upon certainty, if there's a text for it. And if there's no text, then it's based upon ijtihad. And if it's based upon ijtihad, what does it do? It has dhan that's based with it now. So, here we learned that fiqh is based upon what? It is based upon ma'rifah, which means what? It based ma'rifah, which means certainty and assumptions. Dhan, no problem. The means that's taken, التي طريقها, the path for it is based on what? Al-ijtihad. Here is where you automatically distinguish between the muqallid and the faqih. What is the faqih? He took the path of ijtihad. The muqallid, he knows, he has a ma'rifah, he shares that with the faqih, but he doesn't use the tariqah of ijtihad. He doesn't have tariqah of ijtihad. His tariqah he uses is tariqah to taqlid. It's to, the sheikh said, and he takes this kalam of the scholar. Are you with me? He has ma'rifah, yes. Whether it's yaqeen, or whether it's what? Dhan. But it's based upon the means of taking from the speech of a scholar. Based in the speech of a scholar. And not speech that's based on ijtihad and striving. Pay attention. Now a issue rises from here. If this is the definition of fiqh, then the person who comes with this, which is ma'rifatul ahkam al-shar'iyya, to have understanding of the ahkam of the sharia, right? Ma'rifah means what? To know. Pay attention. Knowing, ma'rifah means knowing the ahkam, the rulings of the sharia. Sah? The person who comes with fiqh, what's he called? Faqih. Then that means, if he doesn't have understanding of every single matter of the religion, he's not a faqih. Then who's a faqih? This ishkal arises. This point arises. How is that point looked into? The scholars, they say, okay, the ma'rifah is based upon dhan and yaqeen, na'am. But it doesn't have to be musta'id. It doesn't have to be prepared for him. It doesn't always have to have it there. It's as long as if he goes and he researches the matter, he can bring an answer quickly. Not months and years he'll take. He'll bring it back easily, quickly. Because he has the instrument, he has the alah, he has the ability to get the ijtihad sorted. Now, the reason why they said he has to bring it back quickly is because the one who's not a faqih may be able to go and also do some ijtihad and come and bring something to the table as well, but he'll take a bit longer. That's important, that matter is understood. The alif al-lam in al-ahkam, you have to remember, is istiqraq. Some of the ulama, istighraqiyya. Istighraq is anything that you can put in the position, that alif al-lam, you can put in that position what? Kul. Every. So you can say, kullu al-ahkam al-shar'iyya. The alif al-lam, it takes and substitutes the position of the word what? Kul. Some of the ulama, they said, no, the alif al-lam is lil-ahd. And it can't be lil-ahd, because if it's ahd, then it has to be one of two. Ahadiyya, which is based upon dhikri, or it's based upon dhihni, and it cannot take any of the two. And that is al-Mardini took, the view he took. Also the third, which is al-jins. If you say jins, and you say ahkam al-shar'iyya, and you bring jins under it, then the muqallid will enter it. The muqallid, he will also enter it. And we don't want the muqallid, the blind follower, to enter it. Pay attention, it's important that you understand that point. Na'am, al-ahkam al-shar'iyya. Al-ahkam al-shar'iyya. We're going to come to that just later, inshallah. Tattariqa, the means in which the person, the scholar takes. So fiqh means, linguistically, we said, it means al-fahm, understanding. And istilah, and technically it means, ma'rifatu al-ahkam al-shar'iyya. It is to know the rulings of the sharia. Al-amaliyya. We have to add that word al-amaliyya to it. Then the Waraqaat, he didn't add the word al-amaliyya to it. And it's important that we add it to it. So, i'tiqadiyya. Al-ilmiyya. Ilmiyya, ihtiraz of the word of ilmi. So that leaves. That leaves. Al-shar'iyya. When we say al-shar'iyya, what exits, what's not in there anymore? Four things. So when we say ahkam al-shar'iyya, the ahkam of the sharia, first of all, we take ahkam al-aqliyya. Ahkam which are based upon aql. There are ahkams which are based upon aql, which is anna sama'a fawqana, the sama' is above us. That's aql. Good, no problem. Everyone knows that. That's not the what fiqh is. Fiqh doesn't deal with ahkam al-aqli. Nor does it deal with the second one, which is ahkam al-adiyya. That which a person can know by way of norms. Aada. Aadiyya. Which a person can know by aada. Such as what? After you hear, see lightning, the norms is that it rains, or you hear earthquake. Thunder. Al-Ra'd wal-Baraq. What did they? It's a sign. Aadatan, normally, what happens? That's the second one. The third one is al-hissiyya. Hissiyya. Rulings pertaining to tangible things, such as what? That the people realize by way of feeling, or you know. Such as hararatu shams, that the sun burns, wa bardu shita, and then the summer and winter is cold. That's feeling, right? Your body feels it. That it doesn't deal with it. That's the third one. And the fourth one is ahkam al-istilahi is what? Ahkam which a group of people agree upon themselves. They agree with each other on it. Like the people of the language, they said. That the kalima is ism, and it's a fi'l, and it's a harf. And then the definition of ism is this, and the definition of fi'l is this, and the definition of harf is this, and the aqsam of the fi'l is three, and then the aqsam of the ism fi'l is three, and the aqsam of the harf is three. And then they gave definitions to it. Istilah. A group of people agreed upon it. This ahkam, it also doesn't deal with it. What does it deal with? Ahkam al-shar'iyya. Fiqh is ahkam al-shar'iyya. So what's the first ma'rifah? Which is al-ilm, yaqeen and dhan. Second one is what? Al-ahkam al-shar'iyya. It has to be ahkam of the sharia. Good. The third one is what? It also has to be way of amaliyya. Amaliyya is what? Actions. Fiqh doesn't deal with... Fiqh does not deal with ilmiyya, aqeedah. Fiqh, even that though, a big khilaf occurred in this issue. Some of the ulama, they say, no, fiqh, it used to mean before what? It used to mean aqidah as well. Because if you look at some books, what do you find? Sharhu, for example, fiqh al-akbar. That is ascribed to al-imam Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah. Which is a question of its authenticity, whether Abu Hanifa authored it. But fiqh al-akbar. What does it fiqh al-akbar mean? Aqidah. When the Prophet said, بَنْ يُرِدِ اللَّهُ بِهِ خَيْرًا Anyone Allah was good for. يُفَقِّهُ فِي الدِّينِ Allah gives him fiqh of this religion. Does this fiqh mean here or does it mean the whole religion? And then does that not encompass aqidah? Of course it encompasses aqidah as well. So then the scholars, they said, what do you guys mean that fiqh is only amali? Fiqh is only amali, actions only, not aqidah. Well, according to this, they say that. Na'am. And then the last point, which is what? الَّتِي طَرِيقُهَا الْإِجْتِهَادِ The means to get to it is by way of ijtihad. It can't be... What leaves there? The tariqah which a person reaches it, which is tariqaha at-taqlid, blind following. That is not. So what does it mean, ijtihad? It means, التي طريق ثبوتها وظهورها الاجتهاد. It is بذل الجهد. The person gives out efforts and puts efforts to know the ruling of this matter, such as what? Is the niyyah wajib in the wudu? Do you have to come with an intention? The person strives. He says, this is the ruling. This is how to extract it. Is Fatiha wajib in the salah, which is sirriya? Ah. Is it wajib to recite it? Well, jahriya ala ahad al-aqwal. Or also when it's recited loudly, reciting Surah Al-Fatiha, is it strong? Some are saying no. What's the evidence? The ones that are saying no. You don't have to read Fatiha. It's not wajib. They said, Allah said in the Qur'an, فَقْرَأُوا read مَا تَيَسَّرَ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ. Read whatever is easy from you for the Qur'an. So they said, Fatiha doesn't have to be read. Allah says, read whatever you can. And the ones who said, no, you have to read. They said, لَا صَلَاةَ لِمَنْ لَمْ يَقْرَأْ بِفَاتِحَةِ الْكِتَابِ. There's no prayer for the person who doesn't read Fatiha al-Kitab. And then the khilaf came. You're going to sit down. You're going to strive. You're going to come with the effort. And then you're going to look at why this, how to bring the evidences together. Tarjeeh, ta'arud, nusus, what's the dalalat of this lafz, and etc. This is called fiqh. Not, Abu Hanifa said. Not, Imam Malik rahimahullah said. ولذلك, there's two quotes I want to explain to you about both all, which is very important. Which is, Ibn al-Qayyim said, and it's a very powerful speech. He says it in his kitab, I'lam al-Muwaqqi'in. He said, قال أبو عمر وغيره and other than him, من العلماء, from the scholars. أجمع الناس, the people are upon unanimous agreement. على أن المقلدة, that the person who is a blind follower ليس معدودا من أهل العلم, he is not considered and not added to the people of knowledge. A مقلد, a blind follower, is not in the ranks of the scholars. He's not. وأن العلم, because the knowledge is معرفة الحق, is to know the حق بدليله, with his evidence. It's to know the حق and to know it with what? With his evidence, with ijtihad. You see, he said, وَهَكَذَا وَهَذَا كَمَا قَالَ أَبُو عَمْرُ. Ibn al-Qayyim said, that is how Abu Umar said. He's right, incorrect. فَإِنَّ النَّاسَ, because the people, لَا يَخْتَلِفُونَ, they will never argue, أَنَّ الْعَالِمَ هُوَ الْمَعْرِفَةُ الْحَاصِلَةُ عَنِ الدَّلِيلِ, that the scholar is the one who obtained this matter by way of evidence. وَأَمَّا بِدُونِ الدَّلِيلِ, as for the one who got this without evidence, he just got it because Abu Hanifa said, or Imam Malik said, or this said, ha. فإنما هو تقليد. This person is a taqlid. He blind follows. Ha. نعم. Also, he said in another part of his kitab, he said, لا يجوز, it is not permissible, للمقلد, the blind follower, أن يفتي, to give fatwa. It's not permissible. Haram. أن يفتي في دين الله, to give fatwa in the religion of Allah. بما هو مقلد فيه, in something which he's a blind follower in. ليس على بصيرة, he is not of any insight regarding what he believes. He has no evidence for it. He heard his sheikh say it, and he said, Sheikh Barakallah, I don't need to know why your evidence and what you built it upon. I don't need to know it. Just give it to me. Barakallah. And he takes the speech of his scholar. This person, he is not allowed to give fatwa in the religion of Allah. بما هو مقلد فيه, that which he is a blind follower in. وليس على بصيرة, and he is based upon no insight of this matter. He has no knowledge of it. He's based upon it, just the blind following. في سوى, except أنه قول من قلده دينه, except this is the view of the one who is blind following this. This is what he believes. That's all he knows of it. His view on this issue is not based on insight. It's only based upon the view of the person who is blind following. نعم. And he said, Ibn al-Qayyim, the fact that it's not permissible for the person to give fatwa, هذا إجماع من السلف. That's a consent from the Salaf. كلهم, all of them. وصرح بذلك. And that إجماع was brought clearly by Imam Ahmad والشافعي رضي الله عنهما. May Allah be pleased with both of them. And it's important that the person understands that this is the case of a مقلد, and how many people are blind followers who don't know nothing about the religion. مع ذلك, they are giving fatwa right, left, center.